minutes, you have the February 27th and March 1st. You do not have March 8th.
Okay, so let's move to approve the ones we do have. That would be February 27th and March 1st.
You sent them to us earlier, I guess.
Yes.
Okay, make motion to approve minutes.
Second.
Okay.
Okay, next schedule. Can you guys wait 2 more minutes? Are you ready to go?
We'll give you 2 minutes.
No, we're okay. Actually, we could start.
It's not a public hearing, so.
Pulling your leg. Go ahead. What's up?
Want me to do a quick intro?
What's Sam? Yeah, sure.
This is Julian Chris from NextAmp, and there are two solar, we talked about this briefly last meeting, now that I remember, two proposed solar facilities for the Hutkowski property and the Cookout property, and they wanted to talk a little bit about those projects and about entering into a pilot agreement with the town.
Okay.
And you have a copy of the, pilot agreement that NextAmp entered into with the town for the Fairview Farms facility. Other than that, I'll let you guys talk.
Yeah, so that's a great summary. We entered into the pilot with the town of Whately for the Sanderson project at Fairview Farms probably 3 or 4 years ago now. As Brian said, we're about to enter start the public approvals process for the permits for these two projects on Christian Lane. The one on the Hutkowski property is slated to be a 2.6 megawatt project. It's called Long Plain Solar. And the other project is a 1.3 megawatt project called Whately Renewables. So we wanted to begin the dialogue with you folks about potentially entering into a pilot agreement for these two projects as well here in Whately.
Okay.
So the background is, in terms of how it's authorized, is it the select board will be authorized at the annual town meeting to enter into a negotiated pilot agreement with NextAmp, whatever it's going to be, LLC, I assume, mm-hmm. or whatever the name of the LLC is.
These two are allowed by the zoning area. They're in AR1 or whatever.
Yeah, they're going for special permits, I believe, right?
Correct. So they're both in AR2. They're outside of that 400-foot zone where solar is not allowed by right. And we are going for a special permit with the zoning board.
Okay.
And those were filed this morning?
Correct. Friday afternoon.
Or Friday afternoon.
Yep.
So when's the public hearing with the zoning board?
April 6th, I believe.
Okay. Why are you, I see you're asking for 2% rather than 2.5. Why? Other than it's less money, yes, but what's your justification for 2%?
Yeah, so it's more in line, I think the market, or what's become the norm for solar pilot agreements, has evolved since we first initiated discussions around the Sanderson project 4 to 5 years ago. I think the market is in line with 2%, and alongside that, the economics of solar projects in Massachusetts have tightened significantly given what's happened with the state incentive programs. So there's been essentially 2 incentive programs for solar here in Massachusetts. Each one has kind of stepped down the incentives significantly. These projects are likely to be under extension to the second program or a third program that's coming down the pipeline called the SMART program, and each of those have further constrained the economics. And
when you say constrained the economics, you mean reduce the SRECs?
So these two projects will either move forward, either as SREC 2 extension projects, which would be subject to a diminishment of the SREC value if we're able to move them forward under that program. If not, they'll move forward under what's called the SMART program, which will become active 1st of 2018, and that would be even a further reduction. So we don't know which way it's going to go, but whichever way it goes, it's
so
a decrease in the economics.
Reduced revenues from this insulation from the state.
Correct.
Therefore, your escalator is 2%, which you're saying is in line with something. What's it in line with? It's not in line with the CPI, which is 2.5.
Right. CPI is typically 2.5. I'd say the vast majority of solar pilot agreements out there have been with a 2% raise.
Vast majority of solar projects out there in Massachusetts of comparable size?
Correct. Pilot agreements. So we put that out there for consideration. It would help us.
Right. That's nice.
Getting your package, this exhibit C, that's what 2.5% is. Look at the difference.
Yeah, I was looking at the other.
Look at the difference in years.
This is a long agreement. I haven't read the whole thing. That's an older.
That's a Fairview Farms agreement.
But that's, you know, these later years look compared to what the 2% is. I mean, we're talking 8,900 versus 11,000.
25% difference.
Yeah.
Well, per kilowatt, we've got four megawatts. I mean, is it per kilowatt? It's per megawatt.
Per megawatt, and we're talking four.
Actually, it's per megawatt. It should be per megawatt. I thought SRECs were per megawatt hour, not per megawatt.
So SRECs are based on electricity generation, which is correct, per megawatt hour.
Right.
Solar pilot agreements and most of these agreements are
installed capacity rated.
Capacity.
Oh, correct. Okay. Okay, so so we start out nicely, and then of course, it's sort of the same starting point. 20 years. Well, actually, this is not even so 20 years. Compare apples and apples. 20 years here, 89.59, and then this would be
10,077.
Yeah.
So 10,000 versus, well, let's say it's $1,000 roughly difference times the 4 megawatts. That's 4,000 a year difference we're talking.
By the end of the term.
Well, right. You look at what's year. Year 10 is 78.
It's probably about 60,000 difference total.
Yeah.
Which, real money?
In terms of the base price, you know, I've looked around and you see base prices all over the place. You know, you see 12,500 somewhere. You see this one at 6,600. Hadley was 7,500. What goes into that? So in terms of setting a base price, though, I think there was one in Belchertown. I think. Next episode, they went to Belchertown. I think that was closer to 13,000 as a base price. Right. What goes into establishing that base price?
Good question. So, the one key difference is where the project is located.
Yep.
So, if it's located in the Western Mass Electric Service Territory versus, say, National Grid,
I figured you were going to say something along those lines.
The electricity, unfortunately, is worth approximately half of what it's worth in the National Grid Service Territory.
Because
that's what it's sold for.
Well, I know, but.
And so any kilowatt hour that the project generates, you know, in National Grid, you know, you're gonna get on the order of 17, 18 cents per kilowatt hour. And here in Western Mass Electric, it's, you know, closer to 10 cents. So
and
that.
Because why is that difference? What's the discrepancy? Why should somebody across the street get so much more per kilowatt hour?
That's just the way the regulations are set up.
Right, but there must be some justification for such a difference.
Yeah, so the utility has to go through a rate-making process with the DPU, and that's what comes out.
But you don't know what the reason is that the utility's got that higher rate in National Grid versus Eversource.
It's what there's several things that go into it. One is the cost at which the utilities are able to procure the power, and then it's the per kilowatt-hour cost of delivering that power. So.
So this is not the money that ratepayers actually pay. You're saying that an Eversource residential payer versus a National Grid payer, they have that big a discrepancy?
That's correct.
So if I was an Eversource person, which I am, we ought to raise hell.
Yeah.
Why are we paying so much more than National Grid, which is right down the street?
No, you're paying less.
Paying less.
Oh, we're paying less.
Yeah.
Therefore, oh, that's
we don't
want
to say anything.
Never mind.
Delete that part of the tape.
Yeah, so, but we want to get you know, for net metering, of course, we want the national grid rate.
Yeah.
I guess we're not going to get that.
We would like it to.
Yeah, oh, that's, of course you would too, yeah, so.
You bring up an interesting point, Brian, about the cost, the surrounding towns. I was involved when we first set the rate here for the first solar plant with Lynn and Joyce. Mm-hmm. So I was involved in meetings, and the $6,150 or whatever we came up with then was based on what surrounding areas were doing. We got rates, and I don't know if that was an average or high, low, whatever, but that's what we agreed to use based on at the time. Now, if you're, we're saying that Brian's saying that more, the surrounding towns are much higher than that, then I guess that's...
I'm not sure if they're national grid or resource customers.
Yeah, Belchertown is a national grid.
I don't remember who we looked at before when we set up the rate. But,
yeah.
You know, if we're going to go less than the 2.5%, I guess maybe we got to look at the starting rate then. We're seeing that it's higher than what we got here. That's
right.
The other option. Because if we go with this based on the rates we have for these other two solar farms in town, we're setting a precedent. We're going to be sitting here next month arguing with them again, arguing with possibly with them other, well, you're one of the other ones, so. I mean, if we approve two today, you're going to be back next month saying, well, you want two for your other one. What's the stops at? Are we setting a precedent to have everybody at two now?
Oh, the escalator rate.
Yeah,
sure.
The escalator rate.
Let me back up a little. Just the people at home may not appreciate what we're talking about. So as far as I can recap here, we're talking about a large solar array put on somebody's private land, and instead of paying property tax on that array, we're entering into a payment in lieu of tax. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Otherwise known as pilot, and XREC is a solar renewable energy credit. So why are we doing a pilot instead of just taxing this?
Well, that's instead of personal property.
Yeah, personal property.
There's still a property tax that the landowner pays for that you don't get involved in it. It still comes to the town as a tax bill.
That's right. Right, and the property comes out of 61A, correct?
Well, one is, and I think. But I think that would have to change, right? The one that's in 61A would have to go back to regular.
I believe the plan is would be to remove it from 61A, right?
Correct.
And that'd be AR2 again.
Right. Well, that's the property owner's
right
responsibility to do that. So the pilot is in lieu of personal property taxes.
Correct.
And you know, we looked at it the other way. We looked at it before, and I don't know what your costs are to build these, but you know, if you're talking several million dollars, you know.
So instead of us charging them a personal
pilot, yeah.
We're charging a pilot. So somebody's doing better off because we're doing that versus the other thing. I'm not sure what the comparative economics are.
We looked at that before, and if you take a, say, $2 million it's going to cost you to build one of these, and we weren't sure how do you depreciate that over 10 years or 20 years, and we weren't sure of that at the time.
Right. Do we know now?
So I don't think so. You'd get more money up front, and maybe you'd get $25,000, say, the first year, and it would go down to $2,000 after year 10 or something.
Yeah, so it's a six-year maker's depreciation. So it depreciates quickly.
Right.
And to answer, I think what you're getting at.
So a pilot might be more beneficial to the town.
Is it levelizes the revenues to the town, yep. Provides certainty to us for financing.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's a win-win in that respect.
Correct.
Right.
Theoretically.
I think it is.
So, okay, then.
Brian, could you Dan tell us again what you've seen from other towns? What kind of rates are you getting?
Again, I don't know what providers these are from, but and these are the ones that I could find quickly were, well, Belchertown was 13,400. That's what was reported. It's probably around these. I'm not sure.
Per megawatt?
Yeah, so that's a National Grid project that we entered into.
The other one was that I could find, and you can tell me if these numbers are wrong. NextAmp project in Dudley was 12,500. Is that about right?
National Grid as well.
NextAmp in Upton was 12,500. Then there was a NextAmp project in Hadley at 7,500. Those are per megawatt.
So the Hadley project is Western Mass Electric, obviously. The rest are National Grid. Yeah.
And that was in 2013, so it's 3 or 4 years old, I believe, on the first start discussing the pilot.
And do these others have escalator clauses in it?
I believe so. I haven't been able to get the full agreement. I could just find what was reported on. Okay.
Let's see if we can find out.
Those are all 2%.
They're all 2%?
Yeah.
And those are all NextAmp? Oh, okay. Well, let's see what else is going on out there. When do we have to have this? What's the...
There's no deadline per se. We can't enter into an agreement before the Board of Selectmen is authorized to prior to town meeting. So.
Okay, so we have a little time.
We have a little time.
Okay.
But we just wanted to get the discussion going because of the more certainty that they have in terms of financing, probably the better off it is.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm all for solar. I have it on my roof. I've had it for 15 years. So I didn't get any X-rex, but got a big discount.
Why don't we ask them to provide this information to us?
Sure.
Why ask Brian to
research? I will offer this. We've gone through we're doing another project in Hadley, and we've recently been meeting with David Nixon over there, and they've gone through a reevaluation of the pilot under the sort of new program features, taking into account the cost of solar equipment or personal property component as it is today. And with them, you know, I'd invite you to call David or the assessor over there. They've landed at 7,000 a megawatt with a 2% escalator. So that's probably the most similar comparable that's out there. So I would suggest maybe that's a good place to start for additional intel or information.
Their base rate is a 7,500.
They've gone down to 7,000.
7,000.
Subject to town meeting approval.
And you're starting at 6,000.
Well, that's 2014. They'd be starting at 6,000.
No. This is for a new project you're talking about?
Where are we starting?
Correct.
A new project.
Oh, 150. That's old.
So I don't know what the mill rates are in Hadley versus here in Whately, but they've done the analysis and they're comfortable with it. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, okay, David.
So, Brian, you could start year one here at 7,000 or 7,500 and apply the 2%. Tell us what the total would be.
Okay. Well, we need any more info?
No.
And again, these are subject to the granting of special permits by the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Right.
With the hearings on April 6th. So we may or may not have a decision before our April 25th town meeting, but.
Well, we need 2 weeks here, right? Before the April 6th, I'm sure. 27th, I guess. We can get something to us by that day, right? We can talk again.
But what exactly are you looking for them to get to us?
What surrounding towns are doing, right? Base rate and an escalator clause.
I think you said it was 2%.
So the most recent example in today's solar market is Hadley, 7,000 megawatt at 2%.
And the other ones you mentioned in National Grid were also 2%.
Correct.
And they were next then.
Yes.
Do you know if your competitors are offering the same deal?
I think the market has really coalesced around those numbers, 12 to 13 in National Grid, 7,000 in Western Mass Electric, and really I've seen 2% escalators kind of across the board. And so our request for town meeting, I don't know if you would want to have the actual number kind of locked in ahead of town meeting. Typically the warrant article language that we see authorizes the select board to negotiate and enter into such an agreement. So if town meeting were to arrive and we didn't have a rate that was locked in and agreed to, we put it out there that we request for you to still be authorized so that, you know, if we were to reach...
That would probably work, and we can look at the language in our previous articles.
So then we're asking, really, I guess, for Brian to calculate this at 2% and 7,000 or 7,500, sorry.
Can I change the conversation a tiny bit?
Please.
So this is a community solar project, is that right? In terms of off-takers?
Yes.
What does that mean for someone who's uneducated about this kind of stuff, like me?
So under the community solar program, the net metering credits, or an equivalent if it's in the next solar program, will be sold to two types of entities. One is, you know, a large credit-worthy off-taker, say the town of Whately, town of Hadley, town of Amherst, or a private industrial company that is, you know, has good credit. And then the other 50% of the power produced by the project will be sold to aggregated small users, so residential customers, small commercial entities, and will be sold at a discount relative to the standard rate that those entities now pay for electricity. So for instance, we might go out to market to residents here in Hadley saying, we're offering you power from these projects at 85% of what you currently pay to Western Mass Electric for electricity. So it's just a way of saying there's benefits obviously to the town of Whately for the project in the form of tax revenues, but there's also benefits to the surrounding community as this will be a community solar project.
Could we also qualify to get power for municipal buildings, right?
Yes.
Like our school and like town office.
Who decides who you
and the water
power with, who you agree with? Is that your company's decision?
Yes, it is. So we'd be happy to talk to the town further. I think this came up when we met
with
Brian.
That's what I wanted to do.
Right.
A little while ago.
Are both projects community?
They will be.
Yeah.
Unlike the Sanderson property, that's not community, nor is the one behind the transfer station. That's citizens.
Jail, I think.
Citizens Energy.
Yeah, I think it goes to the jail.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And the one across in Full Bloom, that just goes for their own use?
Right.
I'm not sure.
How much is that what
zero,
it is?
Zero use.
What's the timing of this part of it in terms of when you determine off-takers and when you need commitments by and that kind of stuff? When does that happen in the life of the project?
Usually we will get through the local approvals process on the permitting side before we start marketing the offtake. But in a situation where we have, you know, a host community that's interested in the offtake from the project, we can enter into those discussions now. We're happy to do so.
And who would it be, somebody different that we should speak with?
It would be another individual at our company, but we can, you know, tee up those conversations if that's of interest.
Is that something we want to do? You
want
to explore more?
I'm sorry, I was thinking about something else.
In terms of the town being an off-taker?
Yeah, I do. Okay. I was thinking about that. How's NextAmp doing as a corporation in terms of stocks or employee increase or sales increase, revenue increase?
Yeah, I'd say we're doing pretty well. 2016 was a very good year for us. We brought forth about 40 megawatts of new projects.
And are you strictly Massachusetts, or are you?
We are sort of homegrown in Massachusetts, but I'd say strong throughout the Northeast and New England, and expanding our footprint geographically throughout the United States as we speak.
Competing with Solar City, is Solar City still?
They've had their issues.
They've had their issues, yeah. Okay.
So if all approvals go along fine, when you would start construction, what, this year yet? And when would you be online selling power? What's your goal to do that?
So if approvals go well and efficiently, and there's still net metering credits available from Western Mass Electric, we bring this forward, this project forward, as an SREC 2 extension project, and probably start construction mid to late summer.
And that won't take very long, right? Construction.
It's typically a 3 to 4 month process.
Yeah.
So what's the cap on SRECs? Is that undetermined at this point for the SREX 2 program?
The cap?
The number of megawatts that can be qualifying for the program.
So they've extended the program such that there's no cap. If you start construction before the end of this calendar year, then you can qualify. But there has
so
to
be a big rush.
Credits available for that.
But we don't know what's happening after this calendar year yet.
Then there's this new program.
New program, smart program. Whatever. Anything that's called smart raises a flag.
What's the net metering holdup? What's the restriction on that, the net metering credits?
So each Massachusetts investor-owned utility has to allow for a certain amount of net metering within its service territory. And that amount is a percentage of the total load that it serves. So that converts into megawatts. In Western Mass Electric service territory, there's on the order of 4 to 5 megawatts of private net metering cap available. And that's what we need in order to sell this project as community solar. So if that cap space erodes between now and when we get our approvals, then we're either looking for a net metering cap raise, which would be a legislative action, or we're pushed out into the smart program. Mm.
And you're competing with other outfits for those same numbers?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, safe to say that other developers are out there doing the same thing right now, trying to get projects through local approvals so that they can access those net metering credits.
Okay, well, there's grist for the mill.
All right. We had a proposal several months ago here at one of our meetings. Whatever happened with that?
I don't know.
Were you on board, Brian?
He wasn't here. Never came back, as far as I know.
Yeah, we met with these guys. I think they were from Connecticut, as I recall.
I don't remember. You weren't here then. It was earlier in 2016, I guess.
Yeah. Huh. So the other thing that makes these projects real, which may be atypical relative to some of the other projects that you speak about with other developers, is that we're essentially through the interconnection process with the utility. Oftentimes that's done sort of in parallel with permitting, but we've already have our interconnect here.
And that can be very time-consuming and expensive.
Correct.
So I was involved. Yeah, there was a group up in Greenfield that did their own solar. It was cooperative solar, and they faced the $600,000 connection fee, which was substantial. But I guess if they can get it, they will. So, okay, well, I don't have any more questions here. Fred?
No.
I'll be in touch about let's be in touch about next steps in terms of getting a contact for the off-taking and talking a little bit more about town meeting. Does that work?
If you had approval by our town meeting, that would be good, I would think.
That would be a positive thing for our financing.
Doesn't we have a solar committee or energy committee in town?
We do have an energy committee.
What is there?
It's me and Jonathan.
Have a quorum here.
Let's see, I don't think we met for a year or two.
Should we get input from them?
There's a third one, person who's never appeared.
Mr. Fortune.
Nat? Is on it? And Choice. No,
I
just Nat.
Choice.
Yeah, it is. You're right. I don't even remember which one's on. And Michael Griswold, who never showed up. So, maybe it's time to reconvene. Can you make a note that the Energy Committee should consider this?
Are you more comfortable with the megawatt pricing versus the escalator? Is there an easier way to, as we begin negotiation, would you rather work with the megawatt price or the escalator, neither, both?
Yeah, so the old agreement under Sanderson, the 2.5% escalator,
yeah.
2.5% versus 2%, that's not a showstopper for us. I mean, if it came down to that versus not having a pilot agreement, then we'd be amenable to that. If you want to look at something structured along the lines of the Whately project, a little more upfront, a 2% escalator, then we'd be
amenable
to that.
Well, we just have to run the numbers and get the life cycle cost.
Yeah, no, I totally agree.
Yeah, so we'll do that. Put it in your spreadsheet.
Yep.
No problem.
Crunch it.
Right. Plug and chuck. Okay, great.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
Hey, Keith, did you get my email about that tree that fell on the bridge?
I just did, yeah.
You what?
I just did a few minutes ago.
Oh, okay. You know, the bridge is still gone, and the bed is still sound. It's just the railing got... The railing got crushed one part of it. I don't know if it did anything else to the bridge. The tree broke in like 5 sections. So it was pretty rotten. And that ash up on Top of Hill Road, if you want to chop that up and bring it to my house, that'd be great.
Give the pine with it.
Stack, do you want it?
The pine? There is no pine. I'll take the pine for Kinley.
You gotta take the ethics test again.
Take the pine for Kinley, but there's a lot of board feet in that monster.
Sir.
I was gonna ask, the name of the homeowner that has that frontage grants all those?
Frank and Anita. Frank Spearing and Anita DiMartino.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Moving along. Public comment. Dan, you've already spoken.
No, I know.
No, I know. Anybody else? Keith, you want to? Mary Ellen, you're good? Okay. Okay. Brian, take it away.
I just wanted to lay out our schedule moving forward.
Okay.
So we've wrapped up our joint budget meetings, save for one, with the Finance Committee. The idea was to have the budget meetings when we had all the...
I'm rethinking that idea.
Yeah.
That's all right.
We're through it. We'll have all the department heads that we wanted to come in and present to both boards. So it's going to be a Finance Committee meeting only on the... Obviously, it's open to the public, but attendance is not required. On March 22nd.
Much as I love the Finance Committee, and we've been working well together, I think. I think it's been a positive.
It seems to have gone well.
Yeah.
And then they'll be on the 22nd, and then hopefully we'll talk about the budget more in detail on the Select Board meeting on the 27th.
Okay.
And then this is the last push, that it would be good to have a joint meeting on the 29th with the Select Board and the Finance Committee to talk about any sort of changes or recommendations that either board wants for the final budget.
How does it work if say we have comments on, say, one of the school budgets? Do you deal with them on it, or do they come in and we have a meeting to talk about our concerns with them? Where does that fit into the schedule, or how does it fit
the school budget?
Or any of them to say, Keith's department, we have an issue with his budget.
I would be in touch with them.
You would do that, okay. And
do we have an issue with the school budget?
Well, I don't know.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. Just as an example.
Head down there.
We can all go down.
15 minutes.
But
the hearings today, tonight.
But I guess I'm reading it and the papers in other towns are questioning some items in there. Not so much Frontier's or Whately's budget, but even other towns are questioning some of the increases in there. And it looks like they're going back to negotiate. Either the school is coming back with a revised budget, other towns that they're considering is what I'm seeing in the papers. Now, I don't know, that's why I'm asking, is that still a process here that...
Well, the front
news.
We met with the schools last week, but that would have been a good time for us to bring those up.
But we never told them yes or no on anything, did we? We just listened. The same with all the other departments that presented budgets.
So Frontier will have their public hearing for their budget was scheduled for tomorrow, which is not going to happen. So their public hearing will be rescheduled to a different date. The Whately Elementary School hearing is going on now.
Okay.
Okay.
So we've got the next two or three weeks to resolve any differences if we have them, I guess.
it would be good to get agreement on the budget between the Finance Committee and Select Board. If it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. We can have a discussion at the town meeting as to why that is and different points of view, but hopefully we can come to a consensus.
Well, I don't expect we have any disagreements based on the previous, we've met with the school committees and we've met with the Finance Committee.
Okay, but like I was saying, we didn't say yes or no to any of our items, so when all the numbers are added up, and I guess depends on what that is for our town budget, I mean, if that's too much and we need a cut.
Yep, so the idea here is the Finance Committee will have the full budgets, and they'll talk about that at the meeting on the 22nd.
Okay.
So our board will have the full budgets, they'll talk about any recommendations they have on the 27th.
Okay.
And then we meet at the 29th.
And then, then we meet on the 29th to talk about it. If there's back and forth, we need your questions, we need to ask for department heads. If we know that ahead of time, let me know and I can try and I can get answers.
If there's no problems either committee, do we have to meet at all?
I mean, it's a joint on the 29th.
The joint 29th meeting. Mm-hmm. We're okay with the budget and they're okay with the budget.
Yeah.
We're gonna have a meeting and say we're both okay with it, which I don't know that we need that.
Right.
Just saying.
But, yep.
Okay. What else?
Then the idea would be that the select board would sign the warrant on the 10th of April.
Okay.
So you got really to the 10th, I guess, to resolve differences. 10th of April, I guess. So.
If we need to, we have cushion to set up additional meetings, and if there's something that's pressing, I know Paul loves to hear that.
Yeah.
But one last thing on this, in terms of the annual town meeting, I sent out an email to the department heads and boards and committees that, and this could be for residents who are thinking about submitting a petition, warrant petition. I've asked for the warrants to be submitted by March 15th, so Wednesday.
Got it. I'll be ready.
Is that closed, the warrant, or that's just the end of the submission?
That is when I would like them to be.
Yeah. That's not a closed warrant.
The warrant is technically when the selectman signs the warrant.
Signs.
That's when there's.
When are we signing the warrant?
April 10th.
Oh, okay. All right.
That's at least tentatively how it's.
Good. All right. So I got Jonathan must be at that other meeting. Or maybe not, who knows. Personnel committee recommendations, vacation and sick policy.
Yes. So the personnel committee met.
Which is us.
Which is.
And we discussed it at the finance committee.
Yeah.
The two items we took back to the personnel committee was the idea or the recommendation that the leave time be awarded up front at the beginning of a fiscal year for the upcoming fiscal year, and also a concern about the financial liability of carrying over so much vacation time. So what the personnel committee came back with, instead of being allowed to carry over your full amount of vacation time, it was recommended that it be 2 weeks, so a 2 week carryover moving forward. And then there was the personnel committee felt strongly that the accrual method was the way to go, that vacation leave is earned every pay period moving forward. With that said, and if that's the way that the board wants to do it, we also have to find a way to transition employees who are on the old system, the current system, to the new system. The old system is you work a year, then you get a lump sum that next July 1st. You work a year, you get a lump sum that July 1st. So there's going to be employees who will get a lump sum from FY17. So we have some employees who get 5 weeks. They'll get a lump sum 5 weeks from the prior year.
If they've been there long enough.
If they've been there long enough. So 2 weeks to 5 weeks, depending on how long you've been with them.
Yeah.
And we want to also get them moving forward in FY18 onto the accrual method.
Right.
So the question was, what's an equitable way to allow those employees to use that time up?
That 5 weeks.
Because it would be difficult for someone who, let's say, gets 4 weeks and on July 1st, and then they accrue four more this upcoming year, then they have eight, and they can only carry over two, so they have to use 6 weeks of vacation time, mm-hmm. or they're going to lose it. Mm-hmm. So we thought, or the personnel committee thought,
you need a drawdown time extended would over be, a fiscal year, right, more than one fiscal year.
An equitable period of time to allow that person to spend that time. And the recommendation was made that it was 3 years,
right.
And after that 3 years, any remaining time that was owed for FY17, I guess, would not carry over. So they have 3 years to spend it. We thought it was an equitable period of time, you know, in lieu of buying it, you know, buying the vacation time back or something like
yeah.
that. And that's what's reflected in the policies here. So that, what we call owed vacation leave, that's going to be tracked separately. So you have really two buckets. You'll have an old vacation leave bucket that needs to be used up in 3 years. And you have another bucket, which is the vacation leave that's accruing each pay period. And that can be carried over. 2 weeks of that can be carried over each fiscal year.
And during the 3 years, do they have to take some of that each year? Or can they wait till year three?
They could. The way that it's written right now, they could do it in year three.
Okay, so somebody could retire, not take any, and in year three get the
10 weeks.
Get the full amount plus the 2 weeks carryover, right?
Theoretically,
right? Somebody didn't use any.
No, because you're accruing.
Not the 2 weeks.
Yeah, but you're accruing.
If you waited until, if you didn't use any vacation, and you waited until the end of that fiscal year, yeah.
They wouldn't get the 2 weeks, though.
Well, no, you.
Well,
you'd have to take 2 weeks each year, year one, year two, year three, 2 weeks, but then at the end of year three, you could take, if you had, say, 800 hours accumulated, you could get paid for the 800 hours, whatever. It came down to that, right?
I just lost you on that one.
You'd have to take it every year, one, two, and three, whatever you accrued, but if you had a carryover, say, of 800 hours in year one, you don't have to take the 800 hours until year three.
Yeah.
Or you right. lose
you
it by
three
year
years.
Three. You got 3 years.
Three,
three,
years,
three,
years,
three,
years,
to three years to lose.
But you could wait till the last 800 hours of year three.
Right.
And then just not work those last 800 hours.
Right. 800, well, plus whatever you accrued that year, if you didn't use any, you could
yeah.
too, so yeah.
I reckon you could.
In a sense, this is a way, by switching over, this will be a way where the town is not, in a sense, quite as liable for the vacation time, I guess you'd say, because you're getting to the point where you're eliminating paying in the rears and you're accumulating, so that
right.
I think that was another reason why our committee looked at switching over. You wouldn't have as much of an unfunded liability
right.
once we get past these 3 years.
The biggest inequity that seemed to exist with the current system is that new employees wouldn't have vacation leave or sick leave until the following July 1st.
Oh, yeah.
Until the following.
Yeah,
so if they were hired in September, they would go how many ever months until the next July 1st before they could access the leave time.
Okay.
That was the main driver of
the accrual from.
And we also kept in there the fact that there will be no, under no circumstances, right. can you use any vacation time during your probation period.
Which is 90 days.
90 days.
Any vacation but sick.
But you're accruing during that time.
You're accruing, but you can't use it.
Right.
Because we don't feel that, especially if someone was to take the job and then find out, well, that's really not what they want, they shouldn't be able to take vacation time at our expense to go do a job interview or look for other jobs
right.
at our on our dime.
Okay, so what is going to be approved at town meeting?
Is that
the policy or the COLA or both?
Right now, we're we're just looking at the policy.
The policy.
The personnel policy.
Okay.
If I'm not mistaken, that's a select board policy.
Regulation.
Right.
Okay.
So we approve it. Or not.
Right.
Can I make a motion? We approve what's being proposed here for sick and vacation policies?
Second. So done.
Okay.
Okay. Shall we go to Housing Trust?
Yes, why not?
So the Housing Trust was approved by the Attorney General's Office.
All right.
Housing Trust bylaw, subject to one change. We'll see if we should add that language onto the...
Now, so if we add it or not, we have the go-ahead.
Yes.
Do we approve that as a board?
Approve.
The trust, the establishment of the trust?
So the next step for the board, this is one of the things that I wanted to talk about tonight, is that the select board is responsible for appointing 5 trustees to the Housing Trust. One of them needs to be from a representative from the Board of Selectmen, and one of them needs to be a representative from the CPC. That's how the trust was set up.
And that's 2 of the 5. And then we can have 3 at large.
Then there would be 3 at large. I have had, and Fred, you're on the Housing Committee, so you can fill me into it. I've had conversations with Richard Tilburg about this, and he said that some of them, I don't know, some or all of the members of the Housing Committee may be willing to serve in that capacity.
Oh, that'd be great.
As a housing, as a trustee, or we could expand the field and look for other people who may be interested. I'm not sure how, if you have any opinions on how we should proceed with this.
Well, so far, to my knowledge, the Housing Committee has not decided on who should be trustees. We haven't meant to decide that. If our chair is doing that, well...
No, I don't want to, it wasn't, so let me elaborate on my conversation with him.
Yeah.
He said that he thought that it would be a good thing for the Housing Committee and Housing Trustees to have the same individuals. In a telephone conversation I had with him today, I asked him, typically that's the case where we get a letter from the board or committee or whatever it is suggesting that these folks be appointed. And that's what I've asked for. If the Housing Committee so wants to do that, that would be a next step that they could take.
So that would take care of 3? Or is that everybody? Because Fred's on that committee, so he'd be the select board rep also.
No, there's 3. There's besides... Well, and...
There's a select board rep.
There's a CPA.
CPA and then 3 at large.
Correct.
And there's 3, so that would take care of the whole committee. Yeah.
There's a CPA person.
Yeah, Catherine.
Oh, okay. Right.
Okay, so... Well, we're meeting on, I think, April 5th, the next meeting date, so I guess we could get a recommendation at that meeting to you. And
okay.
February 10th.
2 of the 5 should be senior citizens. I guess you'd count as 1.
Senior citizen is defined as what, over 50?
65, I put it.
Really?
That's what I put it. Yeah.
So you're not there yet?
No. Keeps me right on.
Discounted Cinemark if you're over 55.
Yeah.
And then that includes everybody. Yeah. I want some people looking for housing.
Okay.
So our next... Right. So the board's next step with the Housing Trust would be the appointment of the trustees. And what we're saying is we would look to the Housing Committee for recommendations for who to be appointed.
Right.
Is that correct?
Yep. Yes, that's correct.
Great.
Blue School.
Blue School, I wanted to just keep this item on here, and Fred and I attended a site visit with the Frontier Relocation Building Committee.
Yeah, something like that.
Subcommittee, Building Subcommittee, Office Relocation Committee, the same committee who moved them to the school. And we took a walk around the building, and we talked about different things. And it seemed clear, and Fred, tell me if you felt the same way, that if the town wanted it, it could have it back terms, meaning it, meaning the East Whately School, the Blue School.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want it anymore, is what I'm trying to say. So, I mean, there's a lot of things that complicate the matter. There's the town and the school district have cross easements over the lots. Septic system is on the town's lot, so there's a lot to the north, the ball field and to the north. And then there's the lot that the school sits on. The septic system for the building is on lot, the town's lot. Part of the ball field is on the school's lot, so there's cross easements for the use of those two parcels. So
it should all be of a package.
In terms of property that's more valuable, you would think that those two lots together have more value. There's issues of I believe that ball field is used, so we'd have to look at other places where we could put a ball field, or maybe there's other fields that could be used. I'm not sure. And that's a conversation we could have with Jonathan about.
Well, the elementary school has some land that's already been used for a ball field. So.
Yeah.
But could we say we took this back? How many acres are we talking about?
Just over two, I believe.
The building itself is like 1.2 acres, and the other parcel with the septic is 1 acre.
So if we took it over, I don't know what we'd do with it besides sell it. Now, it's on, and the market value of that building is probably low, but there's a lot of frontage for somebody to build a house.
But the other issue that we talked about some, and I don't know if it's been, hasn't been resolved yet, is there's an old oil tank in the ground next to the building, or on the building site. And if that's leaking, well, it has to be removed, probably. And if it's leaking, then you've got
to
excavate the material.
Sure.
There, and nobody really knows if, I think we've kind of agreed that the tank has to be removed, but as far as the hazardous material there, nobody knows yet until you excavate or you take some borings to see what's in the ground. And I guess I asked the school committee that was there, that meeting, why don't you have money in there? They have money left in their, I don't know what they call it, maintenance account or moving account or something to Frontier. That they want to transfer, they're going to ask towns to transfer that money to them. And I said, why don't you use that money to clean up the tank, the school, so it wouldn't be a hazard to anybody, whether we're selling it or you're selling it. And I got a negative response to that. And
I think we already transferred it.
Well, I think, well, I
think it's,
they weren't interested in that at all. So it could be a liability to us if we own the building and we can't sell it because the hazardous materials that's there.
It'll make it difficult to transfer the property.
Yes.
With that unknown.
Right.
You know, the town has owned it in the past. The town has used it. So I don't know if we're taking on any additional liability. But in terms of being able to, in terms of a private developer being interested, they would want to know what the potential liability is.
Sure. Right.
So who's liable for that tank as we stand right now?
Typically, it's who's ever in the chain of title.
The school?
No.
Whoever in the entire
whoever
chain
put
of
the
title.
Tank in.
The entire chain of title. What does that
so
mean?
So we could be, because it was there when we transferred the school to them.
I'll double check on that, but I believe it's the entire chain of title.
When you say entire chain of title, which is, I've never heard of before, does that mean the land owner?
So previous owners.
All previous owners. I mean, that could go back hundreds
of
years.
So the reason we'll cut off would be the date of the tank.
Well, who put the tank in? That's what I'm
saying.
So that would be it. That's probably us.
Yeah. So I don't know that the town, and again, this is all stuff I want to check, and I don't know that we incur any additional liability for the tank.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be additional cost to remove it. And I mean, there's asbestos and probably lead paint all throughout the building.
I'm sure.
So there's, I mean, those are two items that if it were to be demolished, there would be a cost to whoever would demolish it. If the tank were to be removed, there would be a cost to whoever's going to.
Well, certainly if the land was going to be sold, let's say for two housing units to private developers, all those issues would have to be dealt with, probably by us.
Right.
So, which gets me back to a suggestion I made a couple of meetings ago about getting our real estate looked into by someone who knows the real estate market.
Yeah.
So that would include all those other properties.
Yeah.
That we're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
Jonathan was going to get me in touch with the commercial builder.
Okay.
Yeah, and I was very interested in that as well, and not only from, I guess, the town's point of view of what to do with the Blue School, but as far as, say, the housing committee is looking at which parcel do we look at to develop some kind of housing project, senior, or low-income housing. And we got the Blue School, eventually the Center School, and mm-hmm. the DeMille property.
I said Blue School probably be the best for that.
Well,
we don't know.
And I guess my thought was to have a committee look at that, look at the three schools. We've got information from Frontier on the condition of the Blue School, the environmental condition. We got the report that they had from a consultant. So we know what problems are there from the environment in the building. We've got a report from Lynn on the issues with the Center School, and we kind of know the boundaries of what we're dealing with at the DeMille property. And my thought is to get a committee together, either part of the housing committee or independent of them, maybe members of the housing committee, to look at these three properties, look at the information we have, get a commercial realtor to come look at them, mm-hmm. tell us what he thinks is the best one to sell or is worth the most money to the town, either one, and also maybe some kind of developer or a contractor in town to say, you know, is it make sense to remodel these,
mm-hmm.
the two buildings at least, does it make sense to do that? Or which one is the best one if you're to remodel? And put all this information together and come up with a recommendation, I guess, to this board as to
yeah.
what
that
we
sounds
do.
Good.
And even, you know, looking ahead, if we want more input, we can do it at a fall special town meeting or something like that. You know, if we want to see the town's reaction to it, what people are saying, you know, if they have any interest in either one of these at all.
So I like that idea with the housing subcommittee.
Yeah.
You know, I guess the housing committee would have to make up the subcommittee.
Right. We haven't talked about that yet because this just came up with the Blue School last week, and that's what we're thinking. Well, 2 weeks ago, when we were with finance, it just came up. So, and we're not meeting again until April. So. And I don't think they're going to want to vacate the Blue School real soon because they also talked about all the records they have there. I mean,
storage.
Every room had boxes piled up from 1935 on to today. And not only Frontier, but Whately, Deerfield, Sunderland, stuff was all in there.
Yeah,
every school district had stuff in there. And their concern of that was how much do they move to Frontier? Well, they don't know if they have room at Frontier to move it. So they could, a majority of it could be shredded, but then they got to hire somebody to shred it, and you're still left with some records that they want to maintain. And we talked some of renting office space here to them. You know,
I think
you mentioned it a few months ago before they decided to go back to Frontier, and they were kind of interested in that somewhat, but they need to figure out how much space they need. And right now, it's anybody's guess because they don't know what they want to keep and what they want to shred. So I think Brian and I kind of told them, well, once you decide on that, let us know, and I guess we can still discuss that. As far as I'm concerned, you know, that space is still available to anybody.
Right. And so meanwhile, either we hire some sort of real estate evaluator, or you guys put your committee together and you do it, or you work with whoever we hire.
Fred's got a woman on the committee that's pretty connected.
Yeah, and she's aware of one or two other towns that have gone through this process.
Oh, I'm sure a lot of them are.
And she has some contacts for that.
In terms of housing, now I think that would be the way to approach it. From an affordable housing standpoint,
right.
There's a lot of developers and folks who might
right.
be willing just to come down and
right.
have a conversation with.
Well,
right.
that's good.
I was hoping to do that.
Because it's good moving. Let's get rid of these. Well, let's do something with these properties.
Yeah. Because I think under the housing trust that we could spend, was it up to, what, $5,000 a year of that money? So if we wanted to hire, say, a realtor to or look at this, or a developer to come give us a quick feasibility study, I guess, of the three, we could do that probably.
I would say.
So,
yeah.
And I don't, get back to, I think what I started to say, I don't think Frontier is ready to move soon, so we don't need a decision at this, say, town meeting or next month.
No.
Right?
We haven't, there's been no formal offer, and
no.
I don't know, and I agree with you, I think the timetable's uncertain.
Right.
I would hope before next winter, but.
Right.
Okay.
It's beyond our control, so.
So we have some direction here.
Right.
It's good. Let's keep it up.
So you agree that I should pursue this with the housing committee to see whether to have a subcommittee or
I think you should.
Committee?
Yeah,
okay.
I think it would be good for the housing committee to have a subcommittee that just starts exploring these
right.
properties.
Right. And I would, the other reason I'd want to do that is otherwise it's going to come down to this man over here doing all that work.
Well, he's probably got other irons in the fire.
He's got other irons in the fire,
but,
and I
know,
think we could
course,
help him as much as
sure.
we could.
Yeah, get that committee going.
Because that was a talk a year or two ago about, you know, putting a property on the market, and we looked at, well, who's going to do that? It was the guy sitting there. And he's got 18 other different
items.
I got
my realtor hat back on.
What could you possibly be doing?
I know, so we're trying to help out
I just sit back
Brian here, so.
All right, well, good. So. Fred will get the housing committee to form a subcommittee. Work with Brian to get a real estate evaluation going. Perfect. Okay, Mass Preservation Project Fund.
So this is the third grant of three that's being submitted for the town hall. And this is due on March 24th.
Oh, yeah.
What I'm looking for tonight is pretty much just authorization from the board for two things. And these are both required for the application. One is, and I didn't make copies of these forms, this is just a project authorization form that would authorize the chair of the select board to execute a contract with Mass Historical Commission if the grant's awarded. So I would need a vote of the select board to authorize the chairman to do that.
Okay, what's the amount of the grant we're looking for?
Well, it's not finalized yet. I think it's between, where was my sheet?
Now, I just wrote
between
a letter of support to the Mass Historical Commission.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here it is.
I wrote a letter of support to our historical people saying that Watermelon Wednesdays would like this grant to happen. So should I recuse myself from signing off on this? I'm happy to do so. I don't care. Fred could sign it.
Well, does that mean you recuse yourself from other decisions on the town hall?
Well,
let's frame the vote as authorizing the chairman, or if he's unable to do so.
Okay, that's fine.
Authorizing.
That's good.
Who's the vice chair?
Okay.
I don't want to jeopardize possible grant, so.
Yeah.
Okay. You were looking, you said 90 to 100 or something?
Yeah, I thought I had the I have the latest budget that they, it's between, the maximum grant amount is $100,000.
Okay.
I believe it's between that. It'll, I think it'll fluctuate a little bit.
Between Brian and the committees, these grants seem to be taking about 100 hours each.
Yeah.
It's incredible amount.
Grants are a lot of work.
You want free money, you gotta work for it.
That's right.
Ain't free.
And then the other authorization would be, this is a certificate of authorization for the preservation restriction. And again, it would authorize the chairperson or if we wanna have someone,
well, this
or
is not
the
involving
vice chairperson.
Direct solicitation of funds.
This is, so, right, so this is, so this would be, this would authorize the chairman to execute a preservation restriction with the Mass Historic Commission, assuming the grant's awarded and assuming town meeting approves the preservation restriction. But we need to submit these two forms with the grant application.
Okay. It's fine.
Okay. So we just need to have the, we don't need to sign it tonight, but
okay.
Before the 24th, I'll be in touch with you.
Okay.
We just need those authorizations.
The next thing I see here is River Road waiver.
Yes. So, River Road, this is the Lakota property. It was in receivership.
Oh. The one with the cats.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the receiver is taking steps to foreclose his lien on the property, or its lien on the property, I should say. So, what you have, or what was in your packet, was the letter from the attorney requesting a waiver of the 90-day requirement. So there's a 90-day notice requirement before it can go to, before it can be auctioned off.
Okay.
So that's a request. Oftentimes, so in this case, it's a foreclosure of a lien, and the property is being transferred subject to the 61A and 61B restrictions. So the town doesn't have an opportunity to exercise a right of first refusal on the property, because those, the 61A and 61B restrictions are going to remain with the property.
Oh, okay.
There's not a conversion of, not a conversion out of the chapter land. So the only request here is that it being the board, waive the 90-day notice of the receiver's intent to sell. My conversations with the attorney was that right now it's involved in bankruptcy court. So they're not sure that it's not gonna happen tomorrow. But they've requested the notice of 90-day waiver. So if we don't grant the 90-day waiver, they wait 90 days and then they do it.
Well, you know more about these legal issues than I do.
Yeah.
I defer to your counsel.
I think it would be fine for the board to sign it. It simply lets the auction go forward within the 90-day period, whereas it could.
This in no way penalizes the parties involved or the, well, I don't know what's happened to previous owners.
Well,
they have no claim anymore.
So they filed for bankruptcy protection.
Okay.
So it's, I don't know the exact details of how bankruptcy court works, but it pretty much stays everything for a period of time.
Well, I guess bankruptcy would enable the creditors of first resort to cash to get their take first, and the owner who goes bankrupt gives up all rights there too.
Yeah.
Would be my guess. So, okay, I don't have any problem signing.
Yeah, I don't either. Go ahead.
Do we all sign it, or is it just?
Yeah. So oftentimes in this case, there's a right of first refusal when it's converted out of chapter land. So that's something that they would want to check with the Ag Commission and the Conservation Commission about, but
okay.
That opportunity doesn't exist here. where we'd be able to purchase the property or transfer our right of first refusal to a nonprofit.
There being no town administrator updates, we could move to...
How about a couple?
Beat me to it.
Two items, how about that?
Well, it depends.
Well, there are another two.
Two items.
Three items.
It could be...
I said some of these already, so... The construction of the vault is out to bid, and those bids are due back March 26th. So that, hopefully that will keep moving forward. We already have one bid, so that's good. There's the famous or infamous four-town regional building use study, which I'm told was done by the Frontier Towns and was looking at regional building use. We are told we should get a copy of that report this week.
Okay.
And I just wanted to, but I was going to remind people about the information session on the town hall, April 3rd, 7 p.m. at the Whately Elementary School. Right. And that's for more information on
day of the week.
Proposed town hall
Tuesday.
Project.
Monday.
April 3rd is a Monday.
All right.
Yeah. Do you want to say anything about the bridge? No. Okay.
Not at this point.
Okay.
Very soon, though.
Yeah, and there is...
April 3rd, yeah.
Yeah, if people are wanting more information on what we're going to discuss at that meeting, there will be an agenda posted on our website, so please look at that.
All right. One down.
There's only one? No, there's two. Vault bids, town building use study.
Oh, right.
Info session, town hall.
That's it?
I promise three.
Okay.
The use study was for the schools, I think, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Yep. See if we needed them all or not.
If there was excess capacity.
So, there being no further business?
Motion adjourned.
Second.
Okay.
Thank you.